Hello, beautiful people. It's lovely to see you all. My name's Maryrose, and I am usually not the MC of A Moveable Beast. The Moveable Beast is really the brain and effort child of David Weiss, who's behind the signball tonight. David has been managing to do this for about a year, and you know, I'm an old, and that means that I've been to so many readings. It means that I have sat in more folding chairs than anyone. The avant-garde sits in more folding chairs than anyone, except people who go to AA meetings. It is the true story. Have you sat on a folding chair and listened for 5 to 8 minutes to someone you despise? Welcome to the avant-garde. This is our last A Moveable Beast of the season. And it's just been a wonderful season, and it's just been really great. Thank you guys, everybody, for coming. We really appreciate you being here. So, as you know, David is actually the person who is the real deal with Sunrise Anchorite. I am what is called an advisor, primarily because I'm unable to commit to anything at this time in my life. So, if you want, the umbrella David has built is called Sonar's Anchorite, and it does a bunch of things these days. It just finished up its first reading period for full of manuscripts. It plans on doing other things. I plan on doing other things with it. It may become a very occasional chapbook publication thing for me. So, if you want to keep knowing about this when it becomes cool again, because the monsoons, they rinse our minds, please sign up on the mailing list that's in the back. That will keep you up to date. Also, if you are here and you want to read, there's also a reading list in the back. Actually, the lovely Naomi has it. And I'm supposed to... David was actually going to do this himself, but we didn't have a sound person, so I will say thank you to Steve I and Solar Culture, who's rented out the space at a very modest amount so we could do this. And it's supposed to be thanking myself, my husband Eric Matchett, and Lisa Martin, Perelli Martin, for paying the rent, which we did. A lot of things going on in poetry in Tucson, and I want to tell you about some of them. So, first, Lisa Martin, who is also part of the rent paying, she can raise your hand, Lisa, please. I wish we had, circus spotlights. Lisa does this really remarkable thing, and that is she, once a month, invites writers to come with her on a hike in Sabino Canyon, and then they sit down and everybody writes somewhere and generates work. Sometimes I believe it's on a theme, sometimes the hike is longer than others, but it's kind of this beautiful opportunity. It's presented partially by POG, another organization in town, and it's also free. So if you are in any way, if that sounds like something you would like to do, talk to Lisa, who's raising her hand again. There she is. I don't walk well, so I have not gone, and I'm oh so envious of all those who can. Okay, here's some of the other wonderful things that are happening, and we're kind of winding down. If you've been in Tucson, it's like this wild frenzy to mid-May, and then everything just becomes calm. So as part of the frenzy, we'll have, and actually this is something that happens through the frenzy. Naomi, the lovely Naomi, who I have pointed out before, runs the open mic at Revolutionary Grounds on the first Friday of the month at 5 p.m. Once again, as I told you, I'm an old, which means that I have literally gone to hundreds of open mic poetry readings. I could tell you the stories, but I won't. But what I will say is I went this month to Naomi's, and I have an MFA, I'm a total snob, and I will say it was probably the most remarkable open mic I've ever seen. Thank you. There was a huge variety of people. There was very little. I also know this is not cool of me, but I actually kind of like writing that sincere, that like, that people aren't doing it for, I don't know, adding it to their CV. It was a beautiful reading. It was probably the best open reading I've ever seen. So that happens first Friday of the month at 5 o'clock at Revolutionary Grounds, which is Speedway and Swan. Speedway and Swan, and they're really nice there too. They have good books about being revolutionary. The other thing that's going on is Pog is still doing yet another reading, and that'll be on the 29th at the Seinfeld Arts Warehouse. Yanira Friedland, Annie Guthrie, and Jennifer Scapitone will read. And that starts, I believe, at 7, but I could be wrong. So if you're interested, check out pogartstucson.org. On April 25th, we will have the Tucson Noise Symposium, which is sponsored by the University of Arizona English Department, which that speaks for itself. And it is at 1731 East 2nd Street. If you like noise and noise music and noise performance, we went before the pandemic, it was really pretty wonderful. I actually like very loud things sometimes. And there are so many open mics and readings going on right now. I went to one at, is it Thunder Canyon?
Yeah.
I went to Thunder Canyon, which was
first
Thursday of the month, Thunder Canyon, which is really remarkable. There's several others that I cannot name off the top of my head, but if you are interested and you are willing to face Facebook, there's a group called Poetry in Tucson, and it's a really mixed bag of a group, but you will know what was going on. Okay. At this point, you better fucking know that this is a safe space. And if there's a problem, talk to me or talk to David. David is bigger. I am meaner. I am not someone who can tolerate that sort of behavior towards others. So, something happens, come talk to me. I'll beat him up for you. Or worse. We're going to wait for the train. Almost all Tucson poetry readings are interrupted by trains. If you see a lot of out-of-town folks, there are two sorts of folks. One who stomp for the train, and one who try to yell over the train. The person who most successfully yelled over the train that I ever saw read in Portland was a poet named Eileen Miles, and she out-talked the train. I was very impressed. So ordinarily, my sheet is informing, like, ordinarily we take a little break here to get food and drink, but I don't know if we want to do that. Could I see a show of hands of people who want to sit there and we'll do our thing? Versus people who want to get wine. Okay, who wants to get wine? I see one person. Go get wine. Okay. Could we do a 2-minute break so people can get wine? I could stand up here and tell you a little bit more about Sonorous Anchorite while people get wine. Okay, I will not do that then. I will just sit here with my little bulleted list. And so, David and I have a disagreement. The disagreement involves that David believes we should not mention last names. And I'm like, well, what if the person has a book and then you can look them up on the internet, da 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 da. And I think that's actually the point of why David doesn't do last names. So I'm going to do first name, last initial. And if I know anything about the person's work, I'm gonna talk about it a little bit. And Our first person who's going to come up and read will be Ash H. And I didn't know Ash H. from the people who live in the supermarket, the people with their clang, clang, clang American plants. I did not know her at all. And I've seen her read twice, and it's really heartbreaking because she is a teacher in the midst of the war against children and against teachers. And I feel really lucky to have her read, and I hope she'll come to the stage now, Ash H.
Yes, I am a teacher. I am a mother. I have four children and two grandchildren. I know I look great. had them very young because I am also an ex-Mormon. I was Mormon for 46 years of my 52. So I have some religious and generational trauma from that. And I'm only telling you this stuff because it really informs my work and you will hear bits of that. So I mentioned this last time and Maggie is here tonight, but I'm taking an advanced class from the lovely Maggie. And when she went to the writers conference, she had brought me back to read this piece from Rachel Zucker's The Poetics of Wrongness. And I think Rachel Zucker wrote a description of my work, but she didn't. She just explained confessional poetry. And so I'm gonna read that because then you'll know what you're in for here. Poems that are called confessional rely heavily on sound and repetitions, use simple syntax, remark on the passage of time, and are less interested in compression than most lyric poems. These poems tend to be narrative and relatively accessible and often include a mix of verse and prose. That seems harmless, but here's where it gets good. They are emotionally shrill, self-absorbed, hysterical, messy, and traffic in shame. They tend to be long, are often written in series, have a strong awareness of audience, and are preoccupied with religion. Thank you, Rachel Zucker, because that is me. Okay. So, the first poem I want to read is The Death of American Education. Was that a train or a car? Anyway, so I wrote this about a year into the pandemic. It was really rough on the teachers. And so this was my poem response from it. All flags at all public schools in all of America should always be flown at half-mast. Mourning the commonplace catastrophic shooting deaths averaging every 77 days. Lamenting the fearful inside lives deliberately destroyed by bullies, adult and adolescent. Sorrowing the martyr teachers as they suffer to their second jobs, exhausted just to make ends meet. Grieving every lost class, classified as an art, and thereby unworthy of the ignorant land's money. Despairing the children who weren't supposed to be left behind, but blend into the facelessness of impossibly filled classrooms. When did teaching and learning become a slow death? Knowledge is knife dulled by a lifetime of trying to cut through ridiculous regenerating red tape. Why am I still here? I thought I knew. Because these days, no matter my current level of dying, I can no longer believe any of our heroic battling even matters. As the children I've pledged allegiance to are used against me until I'm considerably less than half, rope chafing, dying, dangling from the flagpole they've hung me from. I'm still a teacher. That was like 3 years ago. I read this one last time, and I read this in the open mic, and I read this one at Revolutionary Grounds, but I feel the need to keep reading this one, so I'm reading it again.
Good.
We did a response poem and in my class, and I had this, a friend of mine sent me Saeed Jones's poetry. And his book is Alive at the End of the World. And so this response is living in the American apocalyptic genre. The end of the world felt like every other school day. My perpetual teacher sadness distorting reality. Subliminal sorrow translated through 1,000 clinically scared, depressed, medicated, anxious, hormonal use as we wonder when the semi-automatic shoe will fall. Like atomic acid rain burning pinholes into copy paper boxes we'll use to capture selfies after the power runs out. Always unfazed, having drilled the almost useless emergency action plan since Columbine, when the discordant snare drum gunfire announced the end, we just thought we'd lost the 77-day lottery, shambling to our designated spots, clustered fodder for the massacre. Any teachers left slip on coagulating flagstones, dead kid desensitization tripping us up as we stumble through the newly fallen, faces lost in the glint of gripped screen-shattered cell phones, apocalyptic cricket notifications buzzing and chirping forever unread. The jangling croaking is only the campus ravens, bathing in the blood pools, blooming in the courtyard before the cafeteria. I sit, stroking the chestnut hair of a 16-year-old corpse, whose name used to be Eli, but is now Crow Meat. I think he was in my honors English fifth period once. Seems I've failed him again. Well, me, and the state, and the American stratocracy that made anyone turn hollow rage into militia. Staring at the panoramic slaughter, dumbfounded in its useless grammar, tone deaf in the momentary shock of knowing that death literally means left behind, my sadness descends. For if the children are all dead, this really is the absolute end. Unless a blaze of sequence scorches my peripheral, and rising dry eyes, I spy an army of drag queens, gloriously standing silently at the gate, strapped with slung storybook bags and stolen AR-15s, waiting to save us all. Okay, so then Maggie said, okay, now we all have to write apocalypse poems. And so I'm like, I just did. She's like, yeah, and you'll write another. And so I did, and we're moving away from education a little bit and into some other of the things I mentioned before. This is called They Got It Wrong in the End. There were no colorful riders on horses at the end. Sure, there was pestilence and war and death and what was that other one? Famine or conquest, depending on which translation you ask. All those things were there, But then all those horrid, mundane things exist through ages and ages past. Why would anyone think them supernatural signs? When has anyone ever listened to history, let alone prophecy? After we danced naked under the blood moon and frolicked in our sexual excess, loving who and more than we should, we ran hand in hand with our partners, lovers finally equal at the end, born from this apocalypse, the god of all things left alive, running to the end of the world, searching for saviors they said would come, finding none. If Jesus did return, no one recognized him. His skin and features having melted like paint from paintbrushes held by pale male hands before any bombs were even armed. Those old dropped bombs on Japan feeling as far away as Golgotha. I imagine his unseen disgusted wandering, somehow with and without us, amid the indiscriminate rubble of temples, mosques, and cathedrals, yes, the Mormon ones too, making it impossible to drive, all roads leading to nowhere anyway. On the side of the road, my poor mother died, 3 months in for lack of insulin, its price even higher after money meant nothing, worthless kindling. Her pounds of aging faithful flesh just died, stopped. No twinkling translation, no rapture, no resurrection, just decomposing digits, dimming eyesight, diabetic coma, death. Here at the end of the world, those that are left don't pray. We cry coldly into the ashy void, fighting fiercely to stay alive like all the doomsdays before. The gun I swore I'd never carry, that handgun with the laser sight my father bought me when I got divorced, is long out of bullets, and I am sick of eating this fucking wheat. I got just two more. So since I mentioned my mother, now we're going to my mother, who is very much still in the Mormon church, and so we have a little bit of a problem sometimes. This is called inheritance. Susan, can anyone hear your trembling words today? How many times has he said you were wrong this morning amid your geraniums? I never knew that having your ears would be more about the collecting of sharpened words than whether my lobes were attached or not, or that having inherited your tremble and quivering lips would muffle my voice to a mumbling trifle. Your voice drones faintly from 667 miles away, a worn-out gramophone skipping through the same trite collective. Slowly, for the blind, grinding hosannas I stopped choking on just 4 short years ago. My mind often not knowing why. Then other times, Susan, our voices merge into one, and I am so stunned at our chorus of acquiesce and self-deprecative sacrifice, I long for your God's justification. Except he and I can't hear each other anymore, so I stay sore, choosing rawness instead. Well, my eyes are brown, yours, Susan, are blue. Are you invisible too? A sun eclipsed by loud male shadow? Or was your candle slowly snuffed, silent long ago? I mourn its loss with my own. But Susan, as you so often said, the afterlife is where it's at. And because you live for all of that unreal eternity, sometimes I feel like you're already dead. Self-slow death disintegrating until there's nothing left but your ghost. Good thing I still believe in love and resurrection, writhing in the mist of translation myself. Rise up, Susan, Your daughter is screaming. Rise. This last poem is, I haven't read it yet out loud. It probably needs some revision, which I'll do, but it's pretty important to me. There has been some things going on with my school district. I don't know if you know that school districts are being targeted right now by some right groups. They're trying to take over school boards and invade school board meetings. And my school's had the attention of some things as we have inclusion right in our mission statement, diversity and inclusion. And we were taking care of and giving trans students a safe space. And then we became the target for that. And an article was written about our school by a religious right-wing online news group that is attached to Tucker Carlson, incidentally. And so this week's assignment was to use an epigraph. So I pulled something right out of this horrible article and also coincided with Easter. So again, religious trauma. The other thing you need to know is that my third child is trans. And so I'm very passionate about this stuff. This poem is called, "My Mother Wished Me Happy Easter with a Quote About the Resurrection." So here's the epigraph. It's from Arizona. The article is titled Arizona High School's Policy Tells Girls to Leave Their Locker Room If Uncomfortable with Trans Students. Was written by and published by The Lion, which is a Herzog Foundation publication. And I've taken out some of the last names. So here's the epigraph. Jennifer, blank, a mother of four with one student at blank high school, told the Daily Caller News Foundation, the school is embracing a dangerous social contagion and discriminating against the truth. Jennifer blank said she has compassion for children suffering from gender dysphoria, but argued that it was not going to help anyone to pretend it is normal. Jennifer Blank said, some parents have tried to ignore what is going on because it feels like a losing battle. She said that the transgender ideology is a lie and will ultimately fail. Easter morning, I awoke to the buzz of my mother's Happy Easter group text, complete with glittery Jesus gif and a quote from an old Mormon man on the victory of the resurrection, breaking the only two boundaries I've set with her. Seconds later, her second text arrived. She was excited for the Easter picnic. Laying in bed, I angry cried for the thousandth time, pondering which side of empathy my mother and that picnic would be. At the Easter Sunday picnic, the collective quilting group of Jennifers bias bind their holy ideas into prairie points with razor blade edges, heat-made handicrafts cutting the rainbow to ribbons along with the loosely knit identities braver kids than me dared recreate for themselves. Woebegone warriors unstitching society's language surge seams, binding biology's double helix with spandex, boldly crafting their heart's translation. How is choosing the fabric and grammatic trappings of self dangerous social contagion? Like you're not pouring lies down everyone's throat, discriminating against the truth Jesus once preached to make the world go as blind as you. The buttoned-up, tight, white bishop gathers his harpy herd for the outdoor sermon in the pavilion, filled with piles of fried chicken and vats of potato salad. The curled and pressed congregation wilting in the heat as he spits scripture in a shower of sweat and bits of congealed egg. Wrapping hate-warped words in biblical candle wax paper like botched Pharisee leftovers spoken for infection. Victorious resurrection dictating the binaries of heaven and hell's opportunity for eternal torture, like this world's violence isn't enough. Meanwhile, the misbegotten children resurrect themselves, moving beyond pronouns, rechristening in their own names, taking lonely steps along the beach of their own transfiguration. You preach compassion for children suffering from gender dysphoria while simultaneously spewing transgender ideology is a lie? Well, must we continue to pretend your kind of hate is normal? The Daily Caller Caucasian choir of Kates, Tuckers, Neils, Jennifers, and Barts sing their shrill song of finger-pointing shame as their hate-filled hallelujahs and hysterical hosannas drowned out the sounds of the lost crying children. Lambs running from howling sheep-clothed wolves they thought followed Jesus, shearing themselves of the pink and blue colored hair shirts forced upon them from birth. Newly naked gods remaking themselves in their inside image, the savage poetry of writing their own wrongness in spite of the targeted paints on their backs, bringing glorious harmonic transformation. We, the teacher, mentor, foster parent, allied chorus of the world, chant this promise to your church of discord. You will ultimately fail in your antipathic ideology. Love holds this land where all are free to be themselves. We burnt the corpse of your vampire god years ago. And no, mother, I don't care about Easter.
Interesting. People draw a lot of lines in the sand around confessional poetry, but I actually think of you as a political poem. Not, you know, I wouldn't need to know where you stood on anything. I wouldn't even know anything about you because your work is standing on its own as a political statement. It's very beautiful. Thank you. I am a commentatarian, so you people have to I'm apologizing for commenting ahead of time. So our next person is Clark T.
Sound working okay? Yes, thank you, David. Appreciate that. I guess I'm here to talk about my artwork. When I talk about my artwork, I start with my mentor, a very generous man. He looked kind of like Santa Claus, and he's passed about a few years back now, before COVID. His name was Lane Patterson. He's a master folk artist in America, a lamp maker, and he taught me basically everything I know and let me learn by myself if I needed to. So I guess this is going to be for Lane, and I'll choke back the tears anyway. I picked through his little wastebasket that he kept outside. It was like a, you know, big garbage bin, actually. And he'd throw all of his scraps from his lampshades, which is sheet metal, and found metal with beautiful patina. I'd put it in the garbage and I'd go and search through it like a little rat trying to learn something new with the Rat King. I don't know how to put that. That's a bad analogy. I got my start there and spent many, many hard hours developing what I would be as an artist. And that was about 13 years ago now. I still feel young as an artist, but I have to realize I've done a lot of work and I've matured and I'm confident to speak of what I've done. Really what I do is I make garbage look beautiful. I go and scavenge, my head seems to point down, and I look on the ground for things that look beautiful to me, mostly discarded things that people wouldn't want otherwise. Polish them up if necessary and put them all together. So I've got a very large collection after 13 years of collecting metal from the ground, large and small. And I've known Stephen, the provider of this facility, for a long time now as well, and he's been a sort of mentor too, and patient and gentle. So there is one of my pieces here next to the door which enters into Stephen's mask work art, which is vast and really powerful. I oftentimes have to remind myself how talented Stephen is, because wow, that's an amazing artist. And I try not to compare myself, nor do I, with Stephen. And I'm glad to be under his wing here. My studio is right next door at 19. If the door's open, you're welcome to come by. Anybody in here is welcome to come by, undoubtedly. And you can see what I do. I want to say that's all, but it's not. So maybe I'll just read a poem. I've been writing obsessively too. I seem to like to disassociate a lot. I've done that since I was a very young boy. And the train is always a blessing for people on stage. So just before this beautiful, powerful woman came to speak on stage, I was standing next to David fiddling through my phone, and this just popped out, so I took a screenshot, and I'm gonna read this one, which I don't even really remember, honestly. I signed it with my initials, so it must mean it's important to me. So it's titled, A Listen in the Last of Language, in parenthesis, dressed as wings. So here it goes. Swimming in a halo, a fashion for substitutes. For teachers, your headdress, a hole. For the teachers, too hard to reflect, they sparkle with two red eyes, pressed in a wink, they are time to dive the thumbs. For the teachers, insect, time like proper blood, tying the fly for new fishermen, again for ancestors. I'm Clark Longbotham Trujillo, thank you very much.
Yes, thank you so much, Clark.
Can I grab a few chairs?
Please, grab a few chairs. I'm going to move this, but whoever's coming next, unless you're extremely small, are going to have to move it back. No, I'm just going to take it out. No, I'm not, because I can't do that either. Clark, how awesome that you came and talked about your work. It is so... I think it's so important to know that, like, although making art of any kind is, you know, even for me, an avowed non-believer in most everything, is like ultimately a sacred thing, and that one of the things that joins us together is that expansion of the individual that comes along with making artwork. So thank you. So awesome. This is why I love the Moveable Beast. It's so awesome. Anything can happen. And the next thing that's going to happen, since I think David is just about chair fold, is Maggie G.
Yay. are some really bummer places.
Do it.
Before we do that, though, I want to not do that for a hot second. And talk for a minute about how lucky I feel to be here right now. This very I don't know if it may have been rebuilt, but this very building was the very first place in Tucson when I was 17 years old and a freshman in college where I sang my music in public.
Wow.
And that was a long ass time ago, and I'm here and I'm alive, so that's great. Okay, so yes, I'm the person who has the massive pleasure of having a class with Ash and Michelle and some other folks. I can't believe I get paid to do that. That's kind of nuts and also very cool. And my sister-in-law is here and she's never seen me do this. We are, we're lifers together. We're widows together. It is awesome to have her. So hi, Tara. Here we go. Wow, this is gonna be hard for me to read because I'm getting old. This is called Just Because You're Paranoid. Who's in the stove? Neither you nor anyone like you, or groaning sleepers, or police with their bullhorns, those shiny flyers, nor you, nor your friends with their darker tones. Stoves char Maggies and Valleys singing gruesome metal in their voices. Had I in these vile sheets a jet and a sky full of rags for this solo slumber? The ratio of blank longing to blooming darlings to a sky that forgets. Goodbye, outlaw, bickering murderously. Goodbye, your little forecasts of my growing debt. For I'm marked a slattern or a braggart. You can stop now with that cheap holy wine. You can swear spots, biplanes, flying your eyes in chase above me. You can dust me finally, find colder trauma full of its own fullness. And surveilling a series of early mornings that front in rail yards, the myth of majesty, stars unmoving. You guys are gonna have to tell me when to shut up because I didn't note the time when I started, but I'm noting the time now, so I'll pull it together. Okay.
Just don't shut up.
All right. So this one, I steal a lot of song titles and sometimes song lyrics because I am a musician. This is called This Is Not a Love Song, AKA, you just have to imagine Johnny Run singing that. Okay. Summer's dregs a lurid garden, neither death nor a dumping nor any divot aerated. All is owing. We are a void and a winter, all love and hugging, but severe at the ends. This is underlit, a cable soundstage garden, its faddish offerings, assorted sweepstakes of the skull. Stores place orders, stores erect themselves. Swallowing can be eating, can be a table. We will be paid off by midsummer, some with their very parts. Or am I still crazy? Some forest of alarms, never loving. This is the dragon I've hidden, unfolding and unpretty, dear inkblot. Pull lever well and get something good. Then pull harder and prettiness breaks, some milder house where you will scare to. some tillable glen in her hair. You call me a bird, and I call you an idiot. Try to hold it tighter or more becomingly. Even the dog rams its head against the carrier. Can I serve you your bill now? A father who wishes me never born, the broken dryer. Those are kind of old. This is also pretty old. I was lucky enough to go on a writing fellowship to Lithuania, which is part of where my kin is from. And so I wrote this partly there and partly when I got back. And in one of my other classes, I'm teaching Gloria Anzaldúa and her theory of mestiza culture. And so this kind of is an intersection of Lithuania and-ish and Southern Arizona-ish. It's called the Bodega of the Middle. Exactly what does it take to have grown from being a camera into being a gun? The gloss on the matter is tiny and extraneous, boiled potato filled with meat, fried hot dog wrapped in bacon, the bodega of citrus, of the small black dog, of the aging burro, of the armed checkpoint, the unarmed. Baroque detail of Zeta tagging on the interstate heading north, crosses marking roadkill. The bodega of the middle is currently between owners in escrow on layaway. Secessions in succession, duchy, proxy, baja, alta, baja, alta. It is drawn in chalk a meter from rain at the town hall, in unspeakable uniform sprawl, ringing burnt cities. Even as the ladies clutch bags and nod under kerchiefs, the arsonist is paid in a third currency. At the bodega of the middle, one is rarely required to show papers to be any one thing at any one time. Boys or girls and knives magically cling to walls at the ready. Surely there are bodies beneath one's feet. Their owners moving objects a centimeter each night. Bodega of the Dybbuk, bodega of stars or stripes, of piles of hooves and hearts. The coyote, the partisan, dollar is inextricable from meaning. One draws from a bag a wedding ring with someone else's name engraved inside. Wave at the prisoners on work detail on the freeway past the mission. Hold still as the mad rabbi crosses the street toward the cafe, carrying eggs for midnight frying. Bodega of the middle, strands of amber without certificate, bread, soda, piñata, fine linen, horchata, boar's heart, cow's liver, Soviet cigarette, box of chiclets, take what is given up. More minutes. I'm gonna skip, okay. So I am working on a new book, but it's hard coming. It's tentatively titled Red Desert. I'm a teacher. It's a theme tonight. I have no time, ever. but this will be the first poem in that book. It's called The Hammer. I am a dog circling the body of another dog. My brother from far away, fluorescent, unconcerned. The helicopter cannot fly in the wind. My hair gets mixed with particles in air, dust in my mouth as I gasp and spit beside his blue abandoned car. I am a dog who clasps her own leash in her jaw. then sirens do or do not issue sound, but red light flashes. I smell new tires, their asymmetric treads roll over everywhere. He left traces. The brother turns around. The search and rescue. Wet hound snouts prove powerless in the gusts down the hill away from the florid sun. The night is a hammer that descends and crushes my exact animal body, and the howling starts. And this is a tiny piece of a long poem that is tentatively called The Great Writ. The Great Writ is another name for habeas corpus. I'm a lawyer's daughter, whatever. The Great Writ. Show me the body. In the great battle of theater and history, there must be paint to redden his cheek. There is mascara, black as a Bible. He is wrapped in velvet, a hierophant in a godless universe, the dimensions of which he will never calculate, for he is absent, the bluest eyes sewn shut. He would love the mascara and rich fabric, the extravagance of an audience with the carcass to prey upon. Petition. The detainee not conveyed by boat or in air, but across a desert of location to fill with a metal clang, a drawer like in murder movies. Now streaming across his beautiful face, frozen in the past perfect. Other appeals transliterated. Vis Kadal, vis Kadash. I declare under penalty of perjury that he, my Sandman. Is it okay if I do one more poem? I don't want to leave you at the morgue there. That's not cute. Okay. This is actually an old poem, but I saw it today and I kind of dug. I did assign the apocalypse poems. I've written, I was in grad school in 2000, We kind of went apeshit in the late 90s and early aughts in academia about the millennium, little did we know, right? Woo! Okay, so this is called From the Digital Journal, and it's that old, so, that was kind of a new thing. February 12th and winter an empty threat. Summer greened us in, convertible tops, lime. At ideological retread seminars, day campers peed their short sets and we changed them into anonymous poly blends. There is nothing slower than turning from you, from them. Car wheels on gravel mixed with snow, the outer borders of the state and its rehabilitations. May you never leave what you are about to love. Your uniform never more handsome than in a heap on the dashboard, I imagine carries you past the checkpoint. The city smells of sulfur from the outposts. I've been waiting for that song to enter the tubes of the jerry-rigged radio, for that Tex-Mex AM revolution of this is how it goes. Inside somewhere, the children wait for the rain to stop. Thank you, David Maryrose.
Can I be pregnant?
No.
Oh, David, no, thank you very much for making me heard. I was feeling ignored, you made me very sad. Maggie, that was so great. It was so great. It's, you know, I haven't been in Portland long, it's less than a decade, but one of the things that I like is that, you know, I sort of wander around. Yeah, that's primarily what I do. I wander around and go to different things, and although I have a strict aesthetic for my own poem, I'm very widened the aesthetic for everyone else's poems. However, the thing is like, I wander into here and all of a sudden I'm emceeing, which is not usually what I do in this space. Usually I sit in that corner next to Naomi and drink. Today you are the pleasure for my company. But what I'm really trying to say is that I've never heard of Maggie except when Ash says, my teacher is Maggie, and I'm like, great. But everywhere I go, there's people doing exciting things that are so exciting that I have no idea about. And that, for me, is one of the pleasures of Tucson. We're going to take an intermission. You guys should drink the wine and the water and the seltzer and the non-alcoholic beer, also alcoholic beer. And you should eat food which is both gluten-full and gluten-free. But also, most specifically, you should sign up if you want to read, because our open mic section will be immediately after this intermission. Naomi, the beautiful Naomi, is holding it up. So please, I mean, let's just also say for clarity purposes, if you want to come up here and talk about your paintings or your dogs, you're also welcome. Just got quiet. That was very impressive. I used to be so something, it's probably not intimidating, but it was something, that I could actually just stand here and audiences would stop talking. But as I've gotten older, that power has weakened. Now I have to hum at you. And I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. So, some things to say. Per request, I have provided the music stand for anyone who wants to put things on the music stand when they read them. I am not one that actually, you know, turns pages with great aplomb. And so it is the music stand for anyone else who prefers to have their words stay still while they read them. This is our open mic part, and a poet asked me a question. Am I expected to read 14 minutes like everybody else? And I said, no, those are the featured readers. You're expected to read maybe 5 minutes. I mean, maybe more, maybe less. I'm not going to kick you off the stage, even if I hate your work. And I actually, it's very hard for me to hate any poetry. So we can be stuck with a wide range of poetics here. And our first reader is Lou. Another reading we found through Revolutionary Grounds Poetry Reading First Friday.
Pretty graceful going up those steps, huh?
Yes.
As graceful as a sedated yak. Hey, my name is Lou, and I write and I speak the truth as I see it as a black man. Yeah. These two pieces were inspired by two heroes of mine, two beautiful black women. The first one is Billie Holiday. This is called, no, sorry, the second one's Billie Holiday. The first one is Nina Simone. This is called Oh Shit. I'll tell you what freedom is to me. No Fear, Nina Simone. The voice spoke of George Floyd, or was it Anthony Jones, or Donnie Sanders, or Denzel Marshall Taylor, Daniel Pryde, Fred Brown, Maurice Gordon, Sean Furr, Amir Johnson, or was it Breonna Taylor? The voice spoke of another of the 25 unarmed Americans with black skin murdered by the police in 2020. I turned the key. The voice died. I got out of the car and walked into the coffee shop. My Blackberry Sage tea was already on the counter. As always, Corey had seen me park. Morning, Lou. Morning, Corey. I reached for my wallet. It wasn't there. Oh, shit. My car was only 8 years old, but was there a brake light out? Were my tags up to date? How long was the drive home? Drive with the flow of traffic. Don't answer yourself. Stop at amber lights. Stay in the right lane. Do not get pulled over. Corey asked, what's wrong? I forgot my wallet. Dude, just pay me tomorrow. Corey, I'll be right back. I took my black body encased in its weaponized skin, and I drove home in fear. As you probably know by now, this one is inspired by Billie Holiday. This is called Strange Fruit, Again. Southern trees bear strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the roots. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. Critical race theory, or CRT, is an academic and legal framework that denotes that systemic racism is a part of American culture. Critical race theory is not the boogeyman, nor is it a woke plan to make white people hate themselves or teach white children to hate America. There are those who use CRT as a buzzword to instill fear and to get the far right to foam at the mouth. Florida governor and presidential hopeful Ron DeSantis falsely claimed that teaching the history of racism is an attempt to indoctrinate our children to hate themselves. He said, we won't allow Florida tax dollars to be spent teaching kids to hate our country or to hate each other. A person attempting to become the leader of the United States of America purposely misinterpreted critical race theory to censor our nation's history. If we deny our children the true history of this nation, they will repeat past mistakes. For those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it. In March, Tennessee lawmakers, March of this year, last month, Tennessee lawmakers discussed a bill that would add execution by firing squad to the death penalty. Representative Paul Sherrill of the Justice Committee said, and I quote, I was just wondering, could I put an amendment on that that would include hanging from a tree? An elected official on a Justice Committee requested the rebirth of lynching. Southern trees bear strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the roots. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. Thank you.
Lou, thank you so much. That was just So I'm 57, I'm white, and I'm a terrible driver. And I've been a terrible driver in many states. In Arizona, in Oregon, in New York, in DC, in Maryland, in Kansas, all the places. But here's the deal. I'll drive my car, which has often been like a kind of crappy car, you know. I will drive it unregistered. I will drive it uninspected. I will drive it all sorts of tail lights out, and you know, I will drive down the street. And there will definitely be things wrong, and the cop will look at the car, and then look at me, and then move on. And that's fucking wrong. It's fucking wrong that that isn't how we do it for everybody. It's fucking wrong that anyone should have to worry about having their license so they don't get shot. And it's really, really important for me to hear people keep talking about this, keep talking about it, keep talking about it. And I treasure you, Lou, because you are helping us keep talking about it. Because the only way it's gonna stop is if everyone keeps it in the forefront of their head. You know, this is, just because it's not a thing that's not happening to me doesn't mean it's not a thing. Because I am privileged. So we have some beautiful luck tonight, besides Lou's poems, and that is we have two Naomis. And so I have one that I've known for a little bit and one that I've just met. So I am calling the known to me Naomi first. May I drag her upon the stage.
There's more than one of me because it's like an alternate dimension version of me, so it's like, oh my god.
And you're both so beautiful.
Always, we are all beautiful. All right, hello guys.
Hello.
Hi, I'm Naomi. You guys have been awesome. Thank you again for that lovely introduction. Oh shit, that was close. Lovely introduction. Again, I do Revolutionary Grounds. I would love to have you guys all there. Not a stickler though, divine timing. You guys make it when you make it, but you guys make the environment. I'm literally there just to give that space. So the more you guys come out, the greater it gets, and just the bigger and bigger and bigger. So, just doing 5 minutes today, so I'm only doing two poems. I want to talk about love today because it's the one thing I never want to talk about. And not unconditional love, because I love unconditional love, but like, you know how like when you're in love with someone and you don't want to admit that you're in love with someone, so you're just like fighting yourself and your feelings? Yeah. So I don't like to talk about love, but I am in love, but not just with a person, you know? So I can go all day like that. So today, Mercury went into retrograde into Taurus, and I don't know if you guys know what that means, but basically your communication is shot to shit, okay? You're not gonna wanna communicate, everything goes inward, and not just about, it's about everything, about how you view love, how you love yourself, how you're communicating with your partners, how you're communicating with other people, and if you even want to. That's the question, right? Do you even wanna talk? Like, do you even wanna communicate with them? So have fun with that and your own little journey and all of that. So I'm gonna talk about love, the one thing I don't wanna talk about. All right. I can't seem to find how not to want to detach from that word. My power in literature, how do I speak, affects the universe, affects me. But what if I want world peace, or for everyone to know they are connected to source and achieve the awakening of your Sophia DNA code, your heaven on earth? I want for all to know serenity. I have selfish wants. Do they still have to be bad? Is it still selfless? What if we could all allow ourselves to know free will, to embody the wings of angels and demons? Lucifer was the first to show God the love of detachment, to show that he can allow his creations to know both sides of self, the hell we can create with lack of pure love run on fear. He gave choice. So if I want everyone to choose, can then my want be good? So why do I feel so selfish when I allow myself to want him, to feel him, to need him, to want him? And I feel so selfish to want love. Is it because I only want it from him? Falling in love was easy, like breathing. I did it subconsciously and consciously. The air held his spirit, and I can't escape each breath. Each exhale keeps me alive, and I want to not need it. But it feels wrong to deny myself my feelings. So how do I detach myself from a want that is only defined by divine timing and a choice? The freedom of finding ourselves first. I don't want anyone in my life because I want the room for growth. I just allow my portals of connectiveness to remain open, always ready for true love. You just have to step through. Your intentions will guide you. Maybe in the future I can say wish or want I can say wish or manifest or allow, but I'm currently kind of in love with want because it's so flexible, it's fluid, and I can mold it like melted gold. I can play around with the full understanding of the word, the meaning, the purpose of want. So the best part about these love poems is that one is written in the masculine and one is written in the feminine. It's your choice to decide who you love, right? So this one's for all the girlies. I love you, and everything reminds me of you, so therefore I am in love with everything. So life spells out your name, the air holds your wisdom, your laughter, as I ask you silly questions like, do you really love me? The wind dances with lightheartedness, taking me, flying me to her ecstasy. I'll travel wherever. Call me the fool following the sun. One step in front of the other. Belief is my horizon, my new beginning. It blazes wild like her hair. Curls of acid waves. Let me get lost in the addiction of the sense of your holiness. The temple of her body, her mind, where she keeps all her secrets, all the ancient knowledge she was entrusted with. I want to be invited in, like an honored guest. But first, I have to honor myself, because the Empress doesn't deserve anything less than a divine ship. So here I go, on a journey of self-discovery, in order to be worthy of unconditional love, mine and hers. I hope she feels me. I hope she hears all the wishes I have made on stars, on numbers, on birthday candles. Each breath in was her memory, her face, her smile, her grace. Each exhale was the pain of unhealed potential growth. I have more to climb, more to learn, more to unlearn. I hope she sees how I've grown, all with her guidance. Her aura is my light that reminds me I am not alone. I have met the love of my lifetimes, the woman to my dreams, the one who is my equal. I have found you before I found myself, so I am left speechless, left in my ego, left in my childhood wounds. I am sorry, for I know you had your own challenges as well, for the lotus only grows in darkness. I respect you, the ground you walk upon, the words you speak, the love you give. I am in love with the goddess who taught me I am capable and deserving of unconditional forgiveness and love.
My hands get tired from clapping so much. So, in other news, we have the other Naomi, who should never be referred to as the other Naomi, and only referred to as Naomi.
I agree.
So, please welcome Naomi.
Traveling light worker, and I go where spirit tells me to go. And I've been doing this since 2017, when I died in my front yard and I saw the future and I decided I was going to come back and live it. And so here I am in Tucson, Arizona, where I was brought to do cat sitting, and I overstayed my visit. So here I am. I'm going to do two pieces for you today. This first one is a poem that I wrote in 2012 while I was drunk on a electric box where I used to do a lot of sitting. And I emailed it to myself and forgot about it, and I found it many years later, and it had come true, so. There once was a woman who was wrought with dismay as she passed a reflection in her storefront one day. The eyes were familiar and the smile was the same, yet that glint in her hair made her question the name. Who was this old woman she couldn't shake free? And who does she think she's pretending to be? Surely she's lost, but that shadow remained, and it followed her home where her life was contained. When had this happened, the woman bemused? Had it crept up behind her while she drifted confused? Or had she been drifting blissfully unaware as time crept up behind her, thinking she wouldn't care if it drew blue squiggly lines down her thighs past her knees, gnarled up her knuckles and jacked up her toes? But time didn't stop there. It went and flattened her nose, pulled on her breast till they pointed down south, and if that weren't enough, shriveled up her soft mouth. You see, no one ever warned her that earlobes keep growing, and hairs might pop up where they shouldn't be showing, and voices shall quiver, and eyelids will drop as you gaze in the mirror thinking, when will this stop? This much she knew as her life crept behind her. There's so much to lose if she didn't move faster, to bind every moment up close to the heart and relish those seconds, because good times soon part. So cherish the lessons and do it while dancing. Don't sweat the small stuff. Choose friends over fancy. Don't spend any time in what other folks think. And always remember, we're gone in a blink. So someday when passing that mirror of you, you won't be caught speechless with no thing to do. You never will have to say, where'd my life go? And no one can counter, it all was a show. No earthling ever should look back to see that they didn't grow up to be all they could be. Your image may alter, but only you knows that what matters most is how rich your heart glows. So I've never been one of those people that sang in the shower or in the bathroom or anywhere in the car. I didn't believe life was a musical. I didn't sing. And I was in a bathtub in Los Angeles in January, and this song was channeled to me. And it came from the ether. It came from whatever you want to believe in. It's in the beyond that speaks to us, that realm of consciousness that we can reach up and grab, or sometimes it just hits you in the head while you're in the bathtub in Los Angeles. And I hit record on my phone, and this is what came out. And I asked, what is that? And it's a lullaby for growing up humans. Blind to the road ahead, it never even mattered. Blind to the road ahead, there's no thing to be done. Stay right here inside of me. Stay right here. Walk beside me. Stay right here. Hold your horses. Open your mind. Open your eyes. Open your eyes, sweet one. Open your eyes. See who's been with you, life after life. Wake up to remember, wake up to remind. We are but infinite. sparks of the divine. You are infinite, finite, pure. You are infinite, you are true. Open your heart, sweet one, open your heart. Love is in you, love is you. Wake up to remember, wake up to remind, be rekindled with kin and kind. Be unmended, stitches to find, and let your lips flow as I speak through you. Blessed sweet one, the galaxy is proud of you. And when you wake up, I'll be smiling. And when I wake up, you will too. May we remember why we came here, as we remember, words were born here. So be the nesting rest, be the beacon. Hold your torch high as we strengthen. Thank you, Almighty. Thank you, Almighty. Thank you, Almighty. Be with us now. Be with us.
Again, I was so astounded at how awesome you are. Thank you for being so awesome. Our next reader is Baevy.
Woo!
Yay!
Woo! That was awesome. I normally like to print stuff out. I didn't know this was an open mic. I just came to see Lou, who's my friend. And I have poems. I write poems. I'm going to read some from this zine that I wrote called Loser. It's about mental illness and my life like that. Okay. I'm going to read three poems. They're all really short. I write pretty short poems. So it should go pretty fast. You shouldn't be stuck with me for too long. This one's called Punchlines of Depersonalization. The popcorn in the room smells like scratch and sniff. The jasmine in the garden airs cheap perfume. Life from the feedback view exists in technicolor. Your yellow hair is melted plastic. Violets and cherries watercolor my shoulder. Evidence my remember your memorizer. The whites of my eyes could be peeled grapes. Your body steams when your hand has left me. This one's called Seasonal Depression. I have been pushed through a stained glass window where all the nickel violets are ultraviolet dish crack, and Mary is still more virgin than creamed Kleenex, and Jesus carves his eye suns over the suburbs of Bellevue, blanketing the make-believe whips from the weathered-in drug dealers. We could say this, that you don't really know. To be honest, I only have the faintest of clue. For me, it links together like still frames of a fast train mounted on my bed frame. The memories they tangle, they interject back. Now dreams they are faulted to slip tongue, falling out in foreign jumbles, paramounting to motley abstractions or nothing really. And I was gonna share another one, but I was inspired by the love poem, so we're gonna go with the love one.
Yes.
This one's called Use Sharpie Next Time. You jump into the lake, a pencil in the air, one who rewrites often and turns the eraser black, leaving metal to scrape the table surface, in desperate attempts to unsay, undone, refilter your saltwater sinking thoughts. As you break the calm, your hands rush up to meet your face, to wipe the fresh water from your eyes, to brush it from your blackening river curls. Your arms extend out as the prime meridian paddles you back to the ladder, ascending you glistening. Water pouts your lips, doughs your eyes, and magnets spandex to your skin. Your nipples look biteable, your breasts flush my cheeks, not anymore. How many kaleidoscope embers will burn before the pencil turns again? Will we dive into the water, watch the bubbles float from our mouths? One hand on your back, the other hanging in the blue, strumming how weightless I am in your arms.
There are front back stairs and back stairs, so if you're like me and your walking is ephemeral, take the back stairs. Our last open mic reader is either Cat or Cut, both of which are excellent names. On your handwriting, I cannot read.
No, that's all right. Cut is definitely not the worst thing I've been called, so. hey, I'm Kat. I use they, them pronouns. To my fam in the audience, I love you. Apologies to everyone in the audience, because I have not read in years, and I also do not read from my phone. So this will be interesting, but I was talking to my therapist today about how I needed to get back into doing this, and then I had great friends invite me, and now I'm doing it, so. This first one, it's kind of a dichotomy. I wrote it in the early days of the pandemic, which was just like just the mental fuckery of everything that was happening. So yeah, sorry, I'm not gonna explain it any more than that, you'll get it. So the one is titled, This is Not a Poem About COVID. How do these things spread? Slowly, asymptomatically, disguised as something else nondescript and familiar. It seeps from head to chest, follows the pulse, heats the blood, circulating and building until it cannot be ignored, cannot be confused for anything else. And when one body holds it, there is another waiting to make room, lowering its defenses, ready for replication, a shared disease diminishing boundaries. The world is shutting down around us, and from our lovesick bed, we couldn't care less. Part two is, I had four friends die in 2020. how the history of grief is changing, like ton against fabric, sucked in through ragged breaths, like I don't know if this is salt from sweat or tears, waiting in the parking lot for news, like the strength I'm so sorry loses when it has to travel 6 feet, like arms aching from holding emptiness, like I wish I could have seen you one last time. So when I was confronted with the reality of having to come up here and read, I also wanted to challenge myself to read things that I had never read before. So thank you for being my unknowing guinea pigs. This is called You Were Supposed to Be a Cartoon. If I lived this life 100 more times, would I make all the same mistakes to arrive back at myself? Would I eventually unpack the multitudes of what could have been, travel different avenues of pain and pleasure, a knife making love to a wound is still spilling possibilities. Undo the stitches and see what is growing but isn't, yet your skin doesn't look like skin beneath the surface. You were supposed to be a cartoon. Bounce back to sheep after the anvil flattened you. Have eyes come back to iris after they became X's. Be in every episode forever, regardless of what demise befell you previously. Who do you think you're fooling with your survival? We all know how real ghosts can seem. Powered by beliefs, others offer them, like the old gods in the Neil Gaiman book. What if you were reckless for everything that is not loved? Made your heart a shelf for misplaced things that are found to belong elsewhere, a process that never lets the dust settle. I just click a button. I undo one tiny thing. The messages start pouring in. Apologies from people who don't know why they should be sorry. Thank y'all. This is the last one. I am going to explain a little bit about this just because I'm going to Ireland next week. It's been 5 years in the making. My ancestors on my mother's side of my family have been calling me there for a very long time. And there is an unfolding in me that I know is happening and a lot of healing that I think is going to be done, that needs to be done. So this is called My Mother Was a Witch. My mother was a witch. After she rebuked the god of her father, before she surrendered her power to the next man and deity who claimed to love her. Many years before I was born, long before everything that came after. She once told me, teary-eyed, she didn't know how I got to be so strong, but I know she was really saying she didn't understand how she became so weak. Doing what many women feel they must, pushing her magic down until it nestled in the one place men can't reach, lined her womb, seeped into the molecules that would make me, child-born and spell-cast. I wish I could have seen her worship. But I know the moon did. Know it sees my dancing feet as continued incantation. My mother was a witch, and I am her magic unbound.
With the poems on the phone that you never read, or you don't write, or you don't talk about, don't do that. Come back. Come back. Read your poems off the phones. They were awesome. They were really awesome. Thank you. Now, we are going to have another featured reader, Kelsi, in just a second. But I'm going to yammer for a minute. And one of the things I'm going to yammer about is the fact that every time I come to an open reading, I never bring anything to read, and then I really want to read, and I'm old, and I'm a medical marijuana user, so I can't actually recite to you any of my poems here and now, but I can give you a line. So I'm going to give you a line from a poem called The Hours, which is a breviary. That's a thing about praying and hours, but The line is, indifference is the eye's bitter carnival. So that is my very small reading for the night. I'm going to plug a pluggable, which I never do because I never have any pluggables, but this summer I will be starting a small writing class. If anyone is interested in coming to talk to me about their writing, the only rule is I have an MFA, and the thing I am most interested in the world is not watching other people tear each other's poems down, because I believe all poets suck. I'm like a marginally successful poet. Like, I have some books, you know, people have paid me to read, but when I started, I sucked. Most of the work I do, about 90% of the work I do that all you Nuna people will ever see, sucks. And you don't get to go to a poetry class and like tell other people they suck without the recognition that you know you suck yourself. So that is my mantra. Like, none of this mean bullshit, you know? None of this ideology, like, confessional poetry sucks, or language poetry sucks, or whatever. So that was my pluggable. Talk to me if you'd like to know. So the next person, who I've never met until today, is Kelsi H. And she will tell you her last name if she chooses to. Kelsi?
Jumping back and forth, David. Thank you so much. I'm very happy to be here. My name is Kelsi. My last name is Vanada, with a V, actually. I don't know if it's
why. Sorry.
No, it's okay. It's all good. Very happy to be here, and very grateful for those who have read work tonight that has never been read to other people, because I'm going to continue in that trend. So thank you for leading the way. I am Kelsi. I'm a poet, and I also am a translator. I'm going to read some poems tonight that are quite short, so feel free to not clap until the end. There's a lot of quotes in these poems, so I'm gonna experiment a little bit with how to indicate those. I'm gonna try some air quotes and see how that feels. Thanks for being here, and David, thanks for inviting me, and thanks for everyone who worked hard to make tonight happen. Some of these have titles and some of them don't, so I'll just kind of read them all together. Sometimes I call the cat Little Bit. I'm scared how easy she could die. I can fit my hand around her head, and I know what a cat's skull looks like. Sometimes my tattoo aches a little on its mark. Sometimes I override it. Disruption's just another word for nothing left to lose. Yes, thank you. Some of these I think are funny, so please laugh. It will make me feel really good if you laugh. Nothing good ever goes away. I'm quoting, but won't say who. What's everyone's problem with the comma splice? All we want is for someone to cry our name when we enter a room, even on Zoom. It gutted me, a phrase people used who would never touch a gut. It wasn't my science fair project, but I had to sit with it. I was naive because other people wanted me to be, said E. For how long have you, and how alone, how clone? Paul said the only way to acquire a taste is to taste. He meant healthy food, but I'm referring to knowledge of the thing itself. I would have loved to be more self-same, but when I say we in family, I could mean versions of us. If I say are, I generally mean me. It's nice to feel a little pious in the morning. We'll get you the details later. Whatever the measure is, pour enough of our guy in. I can sing but like a child, pure but no vibrato, no art. She had this to say about making befores afters. No longer does anyone want two characters in the now. I'm thinking it's a sound choice. You never reach wrong. A substantial change affirmed in these accidents. To know which painting speaks to you, just wait till which you remember. The prose is all mine. Increase in us true religion. Buck the rules, I said, but he didn't understand. In the hymnal, God's called silent as light. You read that right. Distracted us from what was great about it. Here, small secrecy. It's not for me to look at. At one point, I had the power to change it myself, but the last time I tried it, it wouldn't save. Which way is forward, and what do you mean by move it that way? If the church makes any progress on its three-legged stool. I believed in the impatient runaway phrase. What I'm trying to do is shuffle the deck, increase blood flow to the late-blooming parts of me. Life is a second-hand fan, and I already do. Foremost, the night was, we decided, the best translation, a bit fuera de lo normal. Did my air alter the air in his room? This one has a quote as a title, and don't ask where these quotes came from because I don't know. I've tried to keep track of some of them, but I feel very anxious that I can't tell you where they all come from. Its title is, Let's Finish Our Manuscripts and Call It a Life. I didn't grow up with this creature of salt and water rocking with the stammering of the waves. I'm gaining my fluency, but I've never liked draping things over other things. One disagreement involved the value of owning a vegetable brush. Compatibility measured by how closely your paces through the art museum match, how long you spend at each piece, and how much you want to try to put words to it for each other. The baptism of the Holy Spirit never worked on me as a teen, though there was something swooping in the air in that gym. For an advent in mind. Before taking the 5:30 bus to a cross-country meet in eastern Colorado, where they gave the top 10 watermelons, I'd look at my made bed and think, I'll be sleeping here tonight, whatever happens. I may be playing to the crowd, but a portrait when language is gesture. Gesto, that word I never can translate. Sus gestos indican, what? Once I said, made in God's image must also mean body. In other words, we get a lot of practice breaking up. Anchor us, a chorus. The poem had flipped to French, but I didn't realize. Have I manipulated a body into the form of a body I have known? Wood type absorbs ink endlessly. Now I know it could be me who isn't, whose wonderful laugh. Thank you. Concept index. Bad art looks better in a good frame. A floating frame or a float mount on uncut matte board blank with deckel edges visible. Mom's canvases dispense with frames. I spilled on one once and she said, just take a damp rag and wipe it off. It does not do harm to the mystery to know a little more about it. Not all art is so familiar. Familial. Maybe you've noticed every poet has a way they hold their mouth. Tonight we're playing Shit We Hope the President Will Say, a tendering process, despite the name. I still like it, Kirsten said of the song I hummed to her through my phone. She knew the title right away. My best postures when I'm on the move. Everything closer and apart. My unlovable baptism in a blow-up pool, a document designed to melt. The world rocked out of its place by my running. cool hush at the sun behind the hill. Total preference for the second creation story, as long as it's called today. Briefly, not a thing to get over. Someone, probably you. Dashboard. Workshop looked like worship, a mistake I've made before. In fact, the evaluative impulse is so strong that my project is a continuation of last year. Is that your church sweater? Asked a writer of my ivory cardigan at the bar. A page will not sit down, said Susan Howe to her webcam in her office. I need to make eye contact with both people, and one of them is me. What I want is to be handy. In other words, it is a danger to want. I have to coax them, but it's okay. Eyes to endless evidence, violence, enough of edges. How to be so careful it's not obvious. An all-call of finality, stunt double of time. A bonded pair of words, not rhymed. It is difficult to make a pronouncement. Ripeness is, after all, a spectrum in my experience. How a play can mention you not at all. How just one game reveals my lack. Greedily, I read about beautiful corners. Hal on his 80-year-old knees picking up my broken glass plate. I'm relying on memory here. Not all collaborations work out. Sometimes the planning's passed. Little groups kept breaking off when someone would say to my mom, "Can I talk to you?" Grandpa's funeral in cutting wind, my uncle's under adjective, adjective, sun. The body is thick and forgetful. Seeing through water in this state is how all photos appear. Regarding us, I gave this maybe to myself, day of things in my face. Cat can't stop herself swallowing strings. Of my great-grandfather, they said he lived a long, clean life, and in every photograph, he looks mean. I already gave him a preview, but he said meta mistake. At 2, her favorite game was filling bags and baskets with her smaller plastic toys and moving these from one side of the room to the other to unpack them there. For many, faith in supernatural hundredfold returns appeared a reasonable economic strategy. The spot in the sky where the light always snags into a sundog. The dirt of an idiom, the times I've been forced into confession. In that day, they will say to one another, "You're fine, you're nowhere near it, keep coming, keep coming." The blue images get around. On the playground, the children's favorite game is countdown screaming. Should we let it pass? I really liked that moment where the word train came up in the poem. That was perfect. I wish I had a train poem, but I don't think that I do. I'll write one for next time. What's that? I think I have like 3 more. Yeah. Okay, I'm gonna try. You could pull from any number of passages, but you don't. No, I can't. Too loud. Okay. You could pull from any number of passages, but you don't. It's difficult to keep the sundial level. There's a way in which I can't hold everything long enough to write it. Always afterward thinking, did I offend and how? Quick leap to make a sacrament of finding and being found. Or call it a process if you like, if you lie. If I had a dollar for every time I wrote, write a poem about blank and didn't. I make the translation again. An owl's flight is almost silent, but the first time I was high, I could hear a hawk's wings flapping by my ear over the meadow we looked down on. With my eyes alone, I could pull the sun back into the sky and hold off its setting line. Two more. You can make it. This one's called Soft Skills. I made a Reddit to solve my car's mysterious alarm. I called the post Mysterious Focus Noise and filled it with the terms to get mechanics on my side. First clear day in a while, so I cleaned her up, said a silver Focus owner. Mine's red-orange like it's leaking coolant, except it's thousands from being mine. My priest sees energy streaming from the bread and wine. Last one. Thanks for listening. And for getting me through the train.
You're louder than the train.
I'm louder than the train. Okay, good. Since I met him, I've pictured myself often in a handstand. Feet tossed, belly tight, all eyes on me. Some use it ruined me to say a book was good. English, like a caterpillar, just lies down. But the free gift is not like the trespass. The writer who emerged from the house at the house party with a book in her hand she'd wanted to read and left with. Not bad if you can get it, he likes to say. Thank you.
Poets are so good these days. That's what I want to know. I mean, when I started going to open mics, which was probably in the early 80s, before the phone, there'd be a lot of people going, I wrote this on this napkin in the bar last night, and I'm going to read it to you. You've come a long way. Very long way. So, the last piece of the night is a poet's play written by David Weiss, and it will take us about 2 minutes to get set up. Myself, the first Naomi, and my husband Eric Matchett, the guitar player, will be setting up. So, please don't leave if you can possibly avoid it, and we'll be right back. No, if I fall, I fall, yeah.
I mean, I don't think I'll fall.
I know, you should send it.
I'd rather fall than you fall. Like, my medical bill's gonna be a lot simpler than yours.
That is true. And also, my body is so complicated. Mm-hmm. Damn it.
I'll fall.
Awful. I'll fall.
It's all good, it's all good.
It's all good. All
right. Eric, are you ready?
Are you ready? Okay, cool. So, while I'm standing here and we're getting quite ready, I just want to acknowledge how much work David Weiss has put into this series. What David wanted when he started this series was to have poets of all different kinds and artists of all different kinds come together. And that's why you won't see us having this like rigorous aesthetic bent, because there's a lot of places in town where you will see a rigorous aesthetic bent, and this is not that place, because this is supposed to be the opposite of that. And we're very lucky that David has decided to do this.
Yes, thank you, David.
Thank you, David.
Yes, round of applause for David, everyone. He's right behind you guys, in case you didn't know, yes.
Now we're making him blush, which is bad of us.
Oh, so. No, I love it when he blushes. He's like a little school child.
He's adorable.
Like a little school child. It's the cutest.
Yeah, but that, don't say that, though. It'd make him blush more.
But that's the whole point. That's the whole point. Make people blush. I can still talk loud. Like, the microphone doesn't. I don't need that.
I'm not sure these microphones have on-off switches.
Yeah, I'm sure they do. Right? David has.
David does have on-off switches for us. Hobie, you prefer to leave them on. I don't know what that says about David. Are we ready?
I'm ready, if you're ready.
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 All right. Are you guys ready? Yeah, we didn't ask them. Broke our spines, know so much, and feel so little. Zeros, den generations are not potentials in a single thing.
It is not only responsible for the paper clip construction, but it seems to prescript every possible signifying and counter-signifying move as a selection from a repertoire of
ray of
possible
light
permutations on a limited set of
permutations, divisions,
terms.
Exponentations, and sets.
Brian Masumi, parallels for the virtual.
Radiant, unfolding,
bend of your brow,
no thing,
bend of your brow,
libation,
glittering listen,
or bitter tea,
nail scratch, just
pinkness. What remains is
moonlight, bangs, bones, high-minded,
what
tunnel toes, room and barf and siren song, gunning, bare filled, you're a cratering
portion.
Mouth pulling. Mind high, the abstracting manifold saw funnel flume.
What?
This blue to gray to outflux in hell. I saw a starling, and it was pretty and it was gone. Where's the
portion?
Must I purify
what
myself birds of birds things, of flying things that quietly flying things
slab.
That might chirp or screech,
portion.
To a show of wine like a demon, or bang
slab.
Like Satan firing blanks.
Portion.
Still be minor art. My small
what
little god told me so, told me to die to make it so.
Bendy, blown this stone.
We will be welcome in a heaven
bend.
Of written leaves. Rang cafe, college leaves. One
stone.
Day we will,
my
we will come,
bend.
We'll come, we'll come, welcome,
what
welcome,
remains.
We will welcome.
Cells of yarn and
it would
gin.
Be nice to be crucified on a hill.
Garish.
It's a dream, really.
Glow veil.
To be at the nexus of thieves, a sacrifice to save the world and
light.
Set a killer free.
Circle
raised above Golgotha,
in.
Looking down at the pinnacle, maybe
circles
smooth synth
in.
Sit jazz soundtrack.
Johnny.
Vin Savelle would be me.
Even
he has
ten.
The best irises.
And its yellow has its day. Could never.
When I call my dog,
seen.
My god comes. And
could
that makes me sad because I love my dog. When I call my god,
seen.
My dog comes. I'm glad
never
because I hate my god. When my dog calls me, I always
seen.
Come. I love my dog. When my god
never
calls me, I tell that rap bastard to watch a Mel Gibson movie and fuck off. Blending, it makes blending, seeping always,
winds,
the flim-flam, flapping of flags, drawing lines down the middle of every fucking thing.
And their vanities. Waking, speaking, peace before the sun. These others,
do
they cry too? They must, they must. These others, do they cry too? They won't, they won't. These others,
do they
cry too? They must, they must. These others,
do
they cry too? They won't admit that they do.
In pooled water, reflected,
survey a new path, denied a best colorization.
Between
words like rain, rain, like disdain, like pain, can't control the flow. They go where they go, that's the rub. No one will know. It's not that they're useful, they're just art. I'm trapped in a botched marriage with myself.
And I'm beautiful. God,
you're sweet
when you're not here. Intricacies of latex
is
paint
blue
and spun, caught hands on like
water shimmers, butts of
no
pink,
noteworthy homily,
sky and desert
no note
the other. Anna's hum song seems even sweeter.
Some days I just want to be a pony.
Dr.
Bibb told me everybody's gotta serve somebody. Also,
Bobby's such a sweet boy.
Muting dot tone along.
My body seems like a marionette pulled by mind string drudgery. My mind seems to be able to inhabit language, or rather is language, the language I know. Each eye has a language of its own, and or each language owns an eye. I like to fit that my eyes own mine.
The end. Descartes told me that Riri says,
been waiting on that sunshine boy, hurts inside when I look in your eye.
Wouldn't leap. Bitter roots.
These words, they come and they come and they come until they don't.
Behind the
then
tree.
They come and they come and they come again until they don't. Then again, they come and they come and they come until they don't. One day they'll stop
and
shudder, and that's
the last beam. Breath, not drowsy, just beat. Tangy,
truth be, that scares me a bit.
Rain,
not a whole lot, but a bit.
Sporadic.
Part of me wants that to be the end. Another part of me wants some sort of cosmic recuperation of whatever the hell these grassy leaves are. Yet another me wants to sail off into flaming, in a flaming launch and conquer celestial Britannia.
Doorbell rings and dog barks.
Bounded
home.
Home, the capital. The pressures and the fissures. All times and times for choosing infinitesimals as lines drawn in the sand.
You
saguaro forest grow in the home, which isn't mine. Spun film forest, bucolic and contained. No wilderness anymore. Monumental gardens. Levied woodpecker sings gas fueled song.
Baby,
I went to a mosque after 9/11 and asked
and
if they wanted to kill Christians.
Three,
he said,
go to
these deserts and
the
book. They gave me a Koran, showed me the passage detailing Christ's birth,
sleep,
and then fed me dinner.
Little baby. Pinwheel, tears, third eye, prancy,
pilfers, empty, star-filled maids, diadem, disfigured, bulber, vamping, flapping air necessities, textual textiles for blaring with hair, herring, tearing, airing, tamped, time, tipping, tightened, tinseled teeth,
breathing,
meaning lost in a thousand, million, billion, trillion, tiny, transverse tantrums. Diddly dumb, why are you so downcast, oh my soul? Put your faith in Tinky Winky.
And mind and woe and
living
fire.
The terrible
and mind and woe.
The heretical Teletubby of yesteryear.
Fire and
a
mind
done,
and
woe. Resolving resolute. A word is other than a fanning is not quite a home.
Preachy sunshine song.
Plucks a dead drawn electric
cloud
of crackers. Smacks it, feeling elastic, push and pull.
Bold among 10 million, 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 million.
Poor steeples have to
house
too hungry. Solve, resolve a nunnery. A mocking hum, hum, hum,
fire
humming. Churlish, victrola, spittens, fiddle spine, trimling. Couldn't perceive myself even if I wanted to. Two
million and million and million and million and million
to you, two new unfeasible apostate vespers.
Rapacious
radiant oomph.
As
from a photo 40 years prior,
veil
A man falls from a helicopter as it flies away.
Lowers.
From a photo yesterday.
Again.
A man falls under a Globemaster's tire as it takes off for taxi.
The outrageous vulnerability of belief.
Encoded throb of rheostat soul.
Oops, we did it again.
Seeking, not happy.
And I'm so happy.
My slow and outcrop in the blood. Outcrop in the
heart. Down in my heart. And I'm so happy.
Powder.
So very happy.
Soiled powder.
The love of Jesus in my heart.
And if the devil doesn't like it, he can sit on and
outcross.
Sit on a tackle,
bum,
sit on a tack.
And if the devil doesn't like it,
he can sit on a tack.
Imports soiled powder belts, grooves.
20 years of war in 20 years of buckets. There was always something rotten, just pretended there wasn't.
Belt.
This has gone on a long time, the dying. It will go on faster for a while.
Belts. Imposed ruck twirls in axle.
The mother pleading for their children.
Belts.
The girls pronounced women, then married at gunpoint and raped.
Grooves.
The slavery and the stonings.
Household.
The Gerald cells. The organ traffickers.
Belts.
The opium that funds the tarot cells,
grooves.
The heads on improvised pikes,
at
the Americans
soul,
shouting and shooting, the burn pits and the cancers, the presidents and the legislators and the military commanders lying, the war-for-profit corporations, the Afghan soldiers used as cannon
belts,
fodder, then abandoned and blamed,
grooves.
The corporate colonialism,
household.
The lobbyists in squeaky shoes, the IEDs, the six-figure contracting soldiers, the fatwas, the drone strikes,
lucid.
The exploded children, the desertions,
household.
The million-dollar bombing of hovels,
belts.
The bribes masquerading as aid,
grooves.
The promises made and the promises broken,
household.
The huge cash infusions, the corruption, the resentment,
lucid.
And hating, the torture and the spouts. The never really
grooves.
Understanding each other ever. The American people pretending
endure.
To care but not caring. The
endure.
Thousands upon thousands upon thousands dead,
endure.
Dying and maimed.
Endure.
I mean.
To have known the power of Americana
rush to
never was.
The service of brand ideologies, the suffering and
culpability
are all ours, all of ours to cherish and hold.
Reality.
When it can be found,
is singular
and absolute,
an inevitable drunken
taxicab.
They have
strength
and
will
be
able
to
dominate
us,
but social processes can be arrested
neither
by crime nor force.
History
is ours,
and
people make history.
Salvador Allende, President of Chile, September 11th, 1963.
Circle bright.
Done, undone, dunning.
Shadow
this fidgety figuring the fidgety
around
hue, blue.
Prancing.
No rhyme to the indefatigable lancing, the self-propagation lying engine me.
Prancing.
No outside to be fine.
Binder,
would have liked to have known
sing.
A bald space captain and
sing.
Pioneer. We got Bezos instead.
Sing.
Had a phone interview to get food stamps
sing.
During the pandemic. A kind
sing.
Woman read me questions in legalese and typed my responses into a computer.
Filtered water flows over.
The gist of the questions were
rust,
colored
rocks.
Are you a criminal?
Bubbles.
Are you
on
hiding
top.
Money? Why aren't you working?
Down.
Do you want anything valuable? Do you sell three to someone else's valuable? Can you pawn anything?
Synthetic.
What's wrong with you that you can't work?
Bubbles.
Why are you testing good folks' charity?
Trickle, lose.
As I answered,
circle,
I wrote notes on the notepad for the Wounded Warrior Project.
Synthetic.
Along the bottom of this tagline was written,
The greatest casualty is being forgotten.
That's poetry.
Kicking and shrieking.
When I was ill, I visited the Phoenix Museum bar. In the corner of the atrium, a large cascade of exploded firecrackers flowed like a river on the museum floor. The artist, Sergian, would spend months leaving firecrackers and then would be fire department standing by, would light them. The result couldn't be reliably predicted, but the artist dawned at their process. Perhaps it's strange, because of the treatments I was taking, this memory is more fever dream than recollection, with a few specifics to anchor it. I've never been able to find the artist or its work since.
Peso Foman. This ever-hanging
choose someone in Arizona.
Horizon.
Capital of munitions smarter than your
other novel.
The ambitions of kings pass through its leafless trees. The city of golf courses and miniature tall buildings, long runways and half-completed driveways. Host a stirring myrtle, mural, smuggling routes, and underfunded schools.
But
the most white prestige schools gleam so brightly they can be seen for our most non-white factory prisons.
Pebbles.
Dollar signs hanging in the eyes at night, overlaid upon the moon, accompanied by fireworks year-round. A reverie for dead dreams.
This ever cream horizon. Ants on red brick.
Moral inequality arises when there's a job that an apple
started. Sags.
Requiring the complicity of those who do it. Yet, it must be done. Society, nay, civilization requires this. But the work, those who do the work are damned.
Sags. There's something in how a cocker mutt chews a chicken chunk. Cracked soil
creaked. Clover within converse like Claudia Rankin still let me be known lonely about her friend taking lithium.
Cat's claw laces.
It's so obviously good, but I don't like it. Or rather, part of me refuses to like it. I suppose it comes down to a kind of realism. Despite the empathy and humanity of Rankin's words, they're too conventionally melancholy. They're too quiet. Lithium is quieting, but it isn't quiet.
Sky blue shoes amid bright grace. Viridian throated hum.
How quickly after sitting down I become
circular
tired.
Air.
As if I've been fleeing something, fleeing unwork.
Swings.
Now it unwork, I force myself to record these words.
Hush,
so
surrounds.
I might be reminded of my flight at some imagined
hush,
date.
Surrounds a child's cry. A gnat flew in and out my nose, in front and behind my right eyeglass lens. About the edge is of that eye, it hovers now in a beam of sunlight. Underneath a mass of oleanders and grape palm,
I felt the impermanence
and then
of the
alights within my ear.
The impermanence of humankind, this manifestation
as
of nothing in its return.
The sun moves across the sky.
In this mortuary, turned cowboy
a eucalyptus leaf seems to hold
borders around an inner field.
Every possible green.
Catholic icons,
a body.
Spanish.
This
the inner borders
mass
square crosses
among the mass
along
massing
line. Within
stomach
the inner field holes bearing
in
symbols,
its throat
Lord Sigil
imago
royal seal
passing
a cluster of maize plants whose
non
rings like angel
real points
wind.
In time
one of these plants is a tan
would share
cow,
a drink
by a brown husk and surrounded
with a
by
mass,
a black shadow or yellow
a body a mass among the mass massing.
An ode to the god of finger pads, to feel a pin prick picking. This horse was trouble. I prayed to feel the pin.
Stomach in its throat, imago passing non-real points in time. Thank you. I'm gonna speak for all of us. Thank you. Yes, David.
David.
Round of applause for David, who wrote it. Yes.
We just posted this.
The
So, darlings, this is our last reading of the season. We will pick up in August or September, maybe not at this very spot. So, please sign up for a mailing list. Please stay and drink the wine that's left and also eat all the snacks, because this is the last one of the season and we'd like you to provide us with the likeness that comes with carrying nothing home. So, I love you. So, thank you for coming.
Yeah.